What's up, everybody? Happy New Year. Merry Christmas. Happy Master G birthday. That's a holiday. Welcome to the Master G Theater. What's happening, everybody? And I am your host, the Master G. And of course, the crew is here. We are in the building for the 2223. For the 2223. Fulfill your destiny in 2023. That's my new motto. What's up, DJ Boom?
I am still here. Yes. I have not been fired from the show.
No.
I have a voice.
You have a permanent employment and period.
I'm going to use my voice. So,
and DJ Boom is here in full voice. And hello, CLB.
Hello, Master G and my beautiful, our beautiful listeners. Yes. Happy 23.
What's up? And of course, we have the man, the myth, the legend.
Say R.B.
What up, RBI?
Hey, I'm chilling, man. Happy to be back in the building.
Yes. So welcome. And of course, listeners, people, folks, family, homies, homegirls, B-boys, you name it. Come on and claim it. Welcome. It's good to see everybody. If I can see you, and if it's good to hear you, if I can hear you, and I'm not going to say any other cases because somebody might get a little twisted about what I'm talking about. But at any rate, yes. So you know the deal. For those who tune in, what's up? Glad you're back. For those who just tuning in, we have so much fun on this show. We talk about all the cool things. We talk about health issues. We talk about, you know, people in hip-hop. We got some great guests. Of course, the host himself is a phenomenal individual. And
today is an extra special episode.
Super, super special extra episode today because we are going to be joined by
B-Boy King. Rocksteady's own.
Crazy Legs.
The one and only Crazy Legs.
One and only.
So we got one of the greatest, if not the greatest, yes, B-Boy in, yes, the history, yes, of B-Boying,
is our guest. B-Boy royalty. Mm.
Yes, oh, absolutely.
People say, I don't need hip-hop. I don't know. This is royal, right?
Yeah, don't call it breakdancing, by the way.
Right.
It's B-Boying.
B-Boy.
Yeah, all right.
So one of the true elements of hip-hop.
Speaking of which, he's very healthy and fit. You'll have to be to dance.
No question.
But what are you guys talking about?
What are we talking about today?
Ooh, something really juicy, right, yeah, Master G?
Yes. We don't want to give it away, but it's going to have something to do with, you know, controlling your thoughts as a way of fortifying your body. Mm. Mm. That was a nice clip.
That was.
I feel myself nice dangling.
Mm-hmm. Okay, RBI, you good?
Yeah, I'm Gucci, man. I'm Gucci. I got some things I'm trying to cook up back here. So, you know, we work it out and make it happen.
Lots of surprises.
We got some surprises. Again, it's the Master G Theater. I am your host, Master G. I got my man, DJ Boom. I got my girl, CLB, and my homeboy, RBI. Marcus is somewhere in the building. I can't tell you where. But, yeah, we're going to keep it moving. Stay
you must
with us.
Learn. We'll
you must
right
learn.
Right after the break.
Coming right up.
Peace. Just here to let you know, this is Primo. Just here to let you know, my man Black Indian. Just here to let you know, I can't forget my man Black Indian. Just here to let you know, I can't forget my man Black Indian. Just here to let you know, I can't forget Makiko. Just here to let you know, from USA to Japan. On the weekdays, I be in school, be in school learning the golden rule. I wake up in the morning and get out my bed. I don't do a thing till my grace is said. And when it's said, I wipe my ass and think of all the fly girls in my class. Get off the yard, say it can't hurt. I put on my Lees and my blue sweatshirt. Walk around the corner, say to catch the bus. And if the bus ain't there, I don't dare fuss. Just tell my mom I missed the bus today. And she take me to school in a white OJ. But when I get to the school and the bell ring, I don't even worry cause it ain't no thing. Walk in the room and say you're late for class. The teacher marked me late, I'm gonna kick his ass. You know the teacher's gonna listen to me, cause I'm the diabolical, the B-I-Z. And I rock. Just here to let you know, B-I-Z, okay, I want the E. just here to let you know. B-R-E-M-A, okay, don't try to front.
Yo, now that's classic. I ain't worried about you bastards. I'm at home in my boxers. Yo, now that's classic. I ain't worried about you bastards. I'm at home in my boxers. Watch it, Tom. Yo, it's just the river my kick. Yo, while I strangle out the beat while you hear that kick. Yo, now that's classic. I ain't worried about you bastards. I'm at home in my boxers. Watch it, Tom. Wanna classic. It's just the river my kick. While I strangle out the beat while you hear that kick. High drums and snares. Putting you right here. Met your ticket, then I booked it, then I hit that rare air. You don't wanna see black when I get mad, cause I come in black axe, spread black max. It's a real thing while I hold my hands on this microphone. I get it open to the break of dawn, or maybe to the sky, current Caucasian.
Oh, yeah, welcome, welcome back, Master G Theater. I'm your host, Master G, with DJ Boom and CLB, and of course, RBI. And we're going to keep it going and keep it flowing. Uh-huh. And we're going to get into it. DJ Boom, you ready to get into it, DJ Boom?
I'm ready to teach people.
Yes.
Ready to teach them in a segment that we call...
You Must Learn.
You Must Learn. All right, well, You Must Learn today is always educational, okay? But
yes,
today it's educational and it's a bit sad because moments ago we just got the news that we lost one of the most important MCs in DC's hip-hop history. He was also a very close friend of DJ RBI and myself. Rest in peace to Black Indian.
Yes, indeed.
Black Indian was one of the very, very earliest MCs in DC to be signed by a major label.
MCA Records.
In fact, it was MCA Records.
Wow.
He joined the likes in the early days here in DC of DC Scorpio. And believe it or not, Leal. What group was Leal in?
Leal?
Big Leal.
Big Leal. I'm lost on who Big Leal is. Yeah.
Eight.
You think about Section 8 Mob.
Section 8 Mob.
Yeah. Yeah. Yo, you had Section 8 Mob, you had Black Indian, you had Nonchalant, and you had Question Mark Asylum.
They, there you go.
They laid out.
There you go.
You know, the
blueprint.
Yeah.
For DC hip hop. Okay. So this is the scene that RBI and I grew up in. Okay. And after building his profile as a teenager in the group Opus Akabin with Kokai, who is a Grammy nominated.
Yes, sir.
Kokai and Sub-Z. Black and Rush. Black had a rush of exposure with 2000's Get 'Em Psyched on MCA Records, and then slid through the 2000s, releasing two lower profile projects, ditching his long hair and drug habits, and attempting ministry school.
Wow.
That's right. He's well documented in Super Sid's book called Diamonds in the Raw, which can be got on Amazon.
Yeah,
which
it's documents, a good book.
Yeah, it's a good book about the early days of hip-hop here in the Washington, D.C. area.
Okay.
One of the biggest collaborations that he did, one of the biggest kind of moments for his career, was when he collabed with Biz Markie, who also was a local here and lived in Laurel.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Rest in peace, Biz Markie.
Yep.
You said he did two songs with Biz Markie?
Yeah, it's a cut on the Get 'Em Psyched album that they did, and it was also a record that would wound up being an outtake that he did with Premier and Biz Mark. Yeah.
Okay.
I remember he called me. He was like,
But the one you just played was the Premier
one. That was the
one.
Yeah. Okay. He called me. He called me from the studio like, yo, I'm in the studio with Premier. You wouldn't believe it. We ain't here playing pool. You know?
Man.
That's crazy.
And you know, to us, DJ Premier is considered, you know, top three best hip-hop producers of all time.
Without question.
Premier, yes. Shout out to Premier.
Without question.
You know, without question.
Yep.
You know, his real name was Joshua Paul. Really great guy, really great human being. And he had a radio show here at Listen Vision Studios on WLVS Radio called New Energy.
Mm-hmm.
He had that show for 2 years with my guy Tommy. Shout out Tommy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his music for our area was really important because he showed us that we could attain professional levels of excellence and that we could get signed to a major label. And even though I'm from New York, when I came here, this was the scene that was budding.
Right.
Because DC was a little bit behind New York and everywhere else with hip hop.
Yeah.
It was a matter of just from being from DC, it's a lot of industry bias, because a lot of times when it came to doing hip hop from DC, it was almost always assumed it was going to be go-go.
Right.
So exactly. A lot of people just took an assumption and kind of downplayed it. So Black Indian being in the position that he was in, being part of Freestyle Union, which is now a globally recognized organization, being a part of Opazakabin, being one of the first artists to be signed to a major as a part of that group, as a matter of fact. They were on BMG over in France, and I had the personal pleasure of touring with them back in the 90s. They were about as big as Wu-Tang almost over in France.
Wow.
Yeah, so a lot of pioneer moments with that brother right there. He's also a graduate, well, not a graduate, he's alumni of Duke Ellington School of the Arts. That's where we met. And
good school.
Yeah, yeah. He left an impression over there because he inspired other artists who wound up making their own music, who put out their own vinyl, who now have a documentary out, The Amphibians. They were inspired by Black Indian in part. And if you talk to any one of the original members, they'll let you know that. So
yeah, because I went to school actually with one of the members of the Amphibians.
There you go. You're talking about my man Jihad.
Jihad, right.
Yeah, so shouts to Jihad, Amphibians. And
yeah, yeah. You know, sad days, but you know what? I think that we can make it positive because
always make it positive.
All work always at the world's first hip-hop museum, the National indeed Hip-Hop Museum.
Yes.
And it is our job to carry these people's musical legacies.
Absolutely.
And
being the executive director of the National Hip-Hop Museum, it is my responsibility to make sure that these things happen. Proceed, Mr.
We should have a button that just says
that.
That
says that.
Right.
Yes.
Anyways.
This is your director speaking.
I'd like to make a little announcement right here, because our next segment after the break is
going
to be Power Moves with Crazy Legs.
Yes.
So I'm going to make an announcement right now.
You're going to make it now?
Let me say one thing before you do that real quick. Just in honor, you know, I was on my way over here after getting the news, and it just started really hitting me. And just like you guys just said, let's make it positive. I thought about it.
Yeah.
I was sad for a second, but you know what I said to myself?
Yeah.
Especially off the last conversation we had, and I love those conversations where I can sit with my brother and say, yo, man, I love you, brother.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? And share those moments.
Right.
I'm very happy I had that time with
you. There you go.
Yes. You know?
That's what you got to embrace. You know, it's real quick, the fact that, you know, the real mortality, the ideal that your mortality really is coming to play, especially as you get into, you know, like in the ages that like I'm in, and a lot of cats that have come through this hip hop thing, you know, that first generation of people, it's just a real live animal that we have to deal with this. So the thing is, and this is the thing I'm saying to everybody, whether you're in hip hop or not, you have to make every day as if it is, you got to live each day as if it's your last. Live each day as if it's your last. And if it's not your last, fall to your knees, give thanks, and do it all over again in the
next day. Indeed.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
So there you go.
On that note,
yes.
You don't have that other Biz Markie track. Do you have a track we can go to?
Yeah, I do. I do. Okay. I have a bunch of stuff. The ironic thing was I was looking for his album probably about 3 weeks ago online digitally. I couldn't find it. That was a mystery for
me.
I can't believe
now
he couldn't find something.
Yeah. Did you hear what she said?
I can't believe that.
I can't believe it either.
Write that down.
But I do have some selections.
I already know. Whatever.
I got joints.
We got almost a 10-minute mix until we have Crazy Legs on. So let's pay a little tribute to the one and only Black Indian. And when we return, the one and only, the greatest B-boy of all time, Crazy Legs, will be with
B-boy
us.
B-boy royalty. I'm going to say it again. Crazy Legs, stay with us. Master G Theater, it's on, baby.
Peace.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Kokai on the track. My brother, we go back like that.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Kokai on the track, my brother, we go back like that.
Uh-huh.
DC, what up? And why? LA.
I was young, dumb, full of sticky situations like bubble gum. thinking the ways to overcome. Started pumping and got me a gun. A little insane, just trying to have fun. If it wasn't for Slim Cat, I'd be still on the run. Or somewhere on probation, locked down for months. But a couple of miles, David Records and the fat bag of skunk. I gave them what they want, like my name was Tony Blunt. RBI saved my life, can't front. If it wasn't for Freestyle U, there's no telling what else I could do. But Kokai, he put me on a plane to rap from Spain to Peru. This one, RBI saved my life, can't front. If it wasn't for Freestyle U, there's no telling what else I could do. But Kokai, he put me on a plane to rap from Spain to Peru. This one's for the infinite loop. Face D Man, Theory, Head Rock, and 1-2. Team Demolition, Earthbound, that's my crew in Zulu. This is dedicated to you, dedicated to you. This is dedicated to you. This is dedicated to you. Dedicated to who? This is dedicated to you. This is dedicated, this is dedicated, this is dedicated to you. This is dedicated to you. This is dedicated to you. It's dedicated to who? This is dedicated to you. This is dedicated, this is dedicated, this is dedicated. I done rock mics from Japan to Paris, fool. This goes out to my London crew. My people in Quebec, man, how do you do? Drop, get them sights, biz, Marky Lace to do. De La Soul, let me rock on the show or two. For the people that's wondering why I never blew. Well, the industry is funny and it goes that way. Although, when you getting money, cars and clothes and old dogs, but that's another scenario. For these.
Yes, welcome, welcome, welcome. You haven't gone anywhere. No, we're still here. We're still doing it. We're still rocking. Amazing RBI skill set. Okay, I tried to throw his computer on the floor because he's just so damn good. But anyway, I digress.
Let's you digress. Yes. So we're going to bring it back.
Yes, take me back.
To one of the most, forget about hip-hop. He's actually just one of the most inspirational human beings that, you know, America has ever, you know, birthed. Exactly. We're really lucky to have him.
Yes, we are.
Crazy Legs, are you on the line with us?
Crazy Legs.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What's happening, good, brother?
Can you hear me?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Perfect. Perfect.
Yes. First of all, let me just say that I am humbled and I am honored. And I am truly thankful that you have taken the time to be a part of our show. Thank you, brother.
Well, thank you. It's always appreciated. And to what you were saying earlier, you're talking about treat every day like the last day.
Yes.
For me, when it comes to any kind of performance or anything like that, my approach has always been treat it like it's your last performance.
You go. That's right.
You know, because I think a lot of people take it for granted that people will always show up.
That's right.
You know, yeah. You're not always going to get that call either.
Hey, talk to me.
I think it's important we remember that these days. But, you know, when you were first coming of age, okay, you kind of got into, hip hop earlier than most people. Crazy Legs, we always ask all of our guests the same question. Do you recall the very first hip hop song you ever heard?
Mm. All right, so there were no rap records out when I first started breaking. So you got to keep that in mind.
Right.
So I started dancing in 77, and I just know the songs that I heard but had yet to figure out the names of. Of course, I grew up in the Bronx, so I grew up around salsa, funk, soul, things of that nature, and even a little bit of Frank Sinatra.
Yes.
let me see. Wow, that first jam I went to, we were listening to songs like "Give It Up or Turn It Loose." Of course, the usual suspects, Mardi Gras. Mm-hmm. It's Just Begun, Apache, Incredible Bongo Band, mm-hmm. A lot, they did several joints. And Bob James.
Oh, wow. Yeah, yeah.
Nautilus.
Yep.
So, we were, and then you had songs by like people who are from outside of our world, but their music became part of our world because of groups like Cold Crush. Cold Crush was messing with so many different artists. So you heard about a Billy Joel. You heard about Billy Squire. About AC/DC Back in Black.
Yeah.
Because AC/DC, they were using those percussive parts in those songs to spit rhymes over. Mm-hmm. So for me, you know, I was one of those kids who was always trying to like figure out what the name of the song was. So if you heard the song Mardi Gras before you really knew what the song, the name of the song was, we in the hood called it Breaking Bells. You know, or I'm sorry. Yeah. Breaking Bells. And then Last Night Changed It All, Changed It All was called The Telephone Jam.
Right.
Wow.
Okay.
So yeah, those are the things that I remember.
That's but awesome. So the first time you ever heard someone rapping, I'm assuming not only was that on cassette, but was that maybe the L Brothers or Cold Crush or who, do you recall who that was?
It was the first rappers I heard were the original Cold Crush Brothers, which were Mr. T-Bone, Teddy Ted, Little Black, Easy AD, and Cisco Kid. Mm. Now, this is pre-Grandmaster Caz.
Right.
Wow.
This is when Grandmaster Caz was the only Grandmaster Casanova fly.
Mm. Wow.
But did you, I mean, do you recall, because you were already dancing on breaks, do you recall what you thought when you first heard someone rapping on breaks?
Yeah, well, my cousin Lenny Len turned me on to it, and he's the one who put a live jam tape in front of my face and pressed play. And I was just, you know, first of all, I was a shy kid, and I felt like this was just like opening a whole gateway of a new life for me. You know, I'm going to my first jam, hearing the first, for me, what were the first rappers I ever heard of, learning about graffiti. You know, even a year before I went to a jam, I saw Africa Islam and my brother Robert Cologne dancing on Garfield Street in the Bronx, comparing moves, where I thought like, why is my brother on the floor in the street humiliating my family? You know, why is he doing this? And you know, decades later, I actually found out that my brother was part of a crew called The Organization. The Organization eventually became the Mighty Zulu Nation.
Wow.
So my brother was down with them before they became Zulu.
Wow. Now, that's a tidbit of information that many people don't know. That's pretty hip.
Yeah, it kind of makes me old too.
So crazy legs.
But let me tell you,
yes.
The first, here's a little gem. The first battle I ever won, or dance competition, was at the Audubon Ballroom in 1979.
Oh wow.
And the record I chose
Uh-oh.
To dance to was Rapper's Delight.
Hey!
And it was me and my boy Rudy, who became a professional boxer later, but he was younger than me. We were, you figure, damn, man, 79, I was like 12 years old, where I shouldn't have been.
Yeah, right.
There was an event called the Nomadic Disco, and they had a dance contest, salsa dancers, hustlers, all that stuff, and me, I think part of it was a gimmick that we were little kids that they threw us in there.
Oh, yeah, right.
And who knows, I mean, maybe they just gave it to us because we were kids, but we were definitely doing something different. And then, you know, you realize, again, this is where Malcolm X died.
Yes, like, that's going to say the Audubon.
So much history there.
Yeah, the Audubon, you know, is a very historic place in the Bronx. Yeah.
Yes, I used to see Furious Five perform there.
I performed in the Audubon. I had an opportunity to perform in the Audubon early on too, and it was very it was a very weird kind of feeling because I, like you said, I knew Malcolm X was assassinated in the Audubon Ballroom, and when I got there, I was like, oh my God, this is where it happened. And so, yeah, it was a pretty wild night. That I'll never forget that experience. It's funny you talk about
it. I was ignorant to that history at that time. You know, so I had no clue. First of all, I'm 10, 12 years old,
yeah,
whatever.
Right.
So it doesn't really matter.
Right.
Not
it
really
didn't register.
Like that.
Right.
You know, I'm not the prophet or anything like that, the future prophet.
Exactly.
More like a future problem.
I feel you. Trust me. Yeah, so you know, it doesn't register at 12 years old. But, you know, me being 18, 19 years old, of course. At that point, you know, because Malcolm X died when I was very young, but at that point I had never been in the Audubon Ballroom till the night that we performed in the venue. So it was very, 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 like I said, it's even today I still remember how I felt being on the stage, realizing that that's where he was when they came in and, you know, assassinated him.
Yeah, historic.
Deep, right? I know. So let's switch it.
Yes, yes.
Let's switch it. Let's switch it.
Weird right now. Like, yeah. Oh, God.
Yeah, that's wild.
It's nice that there's always, like, all of our guests always have some sort of connection, right, to Rapper's Delight specifically, right?
Well,
and it connotates a certain moment, right, in their life. For Crazy Legs, it was winning that competition.
It's just
wild. You know, for this other person, it was their Sweet 16, you know, or whatever.
It's the wildest thing. It's one of my greatest joys, and it's one of the best gifts that I've been given to be, associated with this music and with this, you know, form of, you know, living that have created. Because like you said, there was no hip hop scene. It was just happening in the Bronx. Nobody even gave it a name during that time. You know what I mean? Crazy Legs. It didn't even have a name. It was just, you know, people was going to parties. Folks was
so you went to that jam?
Right. Yeah. You went to the jam. You get on the floor and dance. It was nothing. There was no title. You know, and now we've evolved to a place where this thing has to have a title. It's got to have category, hip-hop as opposed to rapping, and, you know, b-boying as opposed to breakdancing. I mean, all these different things have come as a result of, you know, the escalation and the eclipse of this whole movement.
Right.
So it's wild that, you know, people like Crazy Legs and myself can remember that time. You feel me? You know what I mean, Crazy Legs? Like, you remember what it was like before it was this. How does that make you feel?
Oh, man, you know, it was all exciting to me back then because I was so young. I was completely oblivious. All I wanted was like some props within like a 20 block radius, and that was my world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so for me, the few songs that made it to the radio, and at that time you're looking at Super Rhymes, you're looking at Funky Four, you're looking at Furious and Sugarhill. I know people talk about King Tim III, but they weren't in the context of our scene.
No,
you know?
Yeah.
So I don't really include that as part of hip hop because you could go to so many different areas of music and find someone saying something in a rhythmic form. Mm-hmm. And even the radio announcers.
Exactly.
Radio announcers were spitting rhymes all the time.
That's right.
Just in like in talk, in a regular speaking manner.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I didn't know how much we needed all of that because it was kind of like a second nature thing. I think people of color, we just respond to beats in a certain way, and it's always going to be like that and manifest throughout time. So, you know, somebody asked me recently, they were like, hey, what would you say is the best thing about growing up back then? And I told them, yo, honestly, it wasn't what we did. It's not knowing how we lived was actually bad. We just thought every day was another day.
Right.
I think it would have had more mental trauma on us if we knew it wasn't supposed to be.
I mean,
but then again, would hip hop have actually come to life if we weren't struggling like that? Because this is the good thing that came out of a bad situation.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it became the voice and it became an opportunity for millions of people as a result of, you know, the fact that, okay, you know, okay, a person's not a singer or a person can't act or a person wasn't an athlete, but a person still had creative skills for writing and they could still put two records together and, you know, create a beat, or they could, you know, put some linoleum on the floor and make a beautiful thing happen. You know, it became the other element. You know what I mean? This is the other element. Mm-hmm. And there are so many people that were able to fall into that element that, you know, like you said, where would we be without it?
It was definitely our alternative form of recreation.
Yes.
Easily.
Yes.
Speaking of that, alternative forms of recreation, I have to ask this question.
I don't smoke dust, man.
Okay, so forget that question. Did y'all have it? No, I'm just kidding.
Wow, you went back on that dust with Crazy Legs.
The leaky knee.
I was like, hold on.
Everybody don't know about no dust now.
Yeah,
you really date yourself when you say dust, right?
Yeah, right.
Especially if you say angel dust. So listen, we are excited to, you know, at some point in the very near future induct Crazy Legs. But our first, you know, experience, you know, with inducting dancers, rest in peace, was inducting Shabadoo.
Right.
Rest in peace.
Shabadoo was a part of the original Lockers.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
And so I'm just asking for just like educational or historical perspective, Crazy Legs. Could you kind of tell me like chronologically, like where the original Lockers were in like the trajectory of like b-boying and dancing to the break?
two completely different scenes. It's kind of like trying to figure out where merengue is compared to salsa.
Wow.
All within the Latin experience, but two completely different dances on two different rhythms. You know? So when it comes to the lockers, they were part of what we, and some people might get mad at me for saying this, but a funk styles movement from the West Coast. They weren't part of the hip hop scene. The only one who probably came close to anything or being from here was Shabadoo, because he, you know, also him being half black, half Puerto Rican, he was getting all of that East Coast flavor as well. But we, you know, I remember every weekend my homegirls would be like, "Yeah, I'll see you after Soul Train."
Yeah.
Or "I'll see you after Sabado Gigante," which is a Puerto Rican thing. Yeah. So these things had, you had salsa or different Latin styles of dance happening on one channel, and then you had Soul Train. And people would steal moves from Soul Train and take those moves into the clubs. And I think New York finally started to develop more of its own style because of hip hop. And it's funny because a lot of people like to think that breaking was what it is now. Breaking back then, you barely hit the floor. So it was a whole different experience. And the Lockers and the Electric Boogaloos were both on Soul Train.
Yes, that's right.
You know, so you had Tony Basil on there. But here's another interesting thing that I just learned recently from Tony Basil, who was part of the Lockers. And, you know, because there's always these, I think, these stupid divisive arguments about whether Puerto Ricans were there. And to me, it's like, yo, do I have to show you my my school pictures from this particular school?
Are you kidding?
In this neighborhood?
Yeah, that's silly.
Who do you think lived there?
Right.
Who do you think, like, when it was time for a party, like, my mom was, you know, doing the bus stop, and then her friends were learning how to do salsa.
Right.
And they were black.
Right.
So I, oh, that's all I know.
Right.
So to me, a black person's issue that works against them is my issue too.
Right.
Right.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
That's how we came up over here.
Yep.
You know, so wait up, what was your question?
Yeah. No, you actually stated it perfectly. Is that popping and locking is kind of a separate community from the breakers.
Yes.
You said
two separate communities, but a genesis happened. Just like breaking existed, graffiti existed, all these, like, if you want to call it jive talking back then, which became rap, you know, it all existed. It's just the genesis happened at a certain time. And that genesis took time, you know, and during those times, there were a lot of things happening. Because if James Brown, and I learned this from Tony Basil, if James Brown was performing at the Apollo Theater, you know, what Tony Basil said was like, she goes, "You know, James Brown used to hang out with Fania All-Stars," which is legendary salsa, responsible for creating salsa.
Really?
And I was like, "What do you mean? I never heard this story before."
Right, me neither.
And she was saying, yeah, it wasn't Tony Basil, it was someone else, I can't remember who. But they said, James Brown was like, "Yo, I got the footwork already. But what these guys are doing up on top, I want to go practice with them." So he used to hang, Apollo Theater's right there, Spanish Harlem, part of
right.
Harlem.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So he would go to where they would practice at and practice with Roberto Rowena, who, if you look at, there's this footage of him when Fania All-Stars was performing in Zaire, Africa. And you see Roberto Rowena jump down on the floor in the most advanced version of what anyone could look at as breaking in terms of modern times. And he was just killing it. And it's like, you know, for me, Roberto Rowena, he's Afro-Latino, whatever, you know. Anyone who's Afro-Latino, we have no beef or anything.
Right.
You know, we're all good, you know. We get to enjoy both sides.
Yeah, you do. Best of both worlds. Yeah.
But if you look at that footage, you'll see, like, the similarities in the way we all get down.
What year
so
was that,
you somebody think? Looking at Soul Train on a weekend to learn moves, it isn't even about, and I'm talking about my black and Latino friends, it's not about colonizing something. It's about That's what I feel. I move to that music more naturally. This other shit ain't for me. Right. Like me growing up in the hood, it was either ballet, tap, or something that worked against being macho in the hood.
Right.
You could catch a beat down for. Right. So, you know, we went for the funk, soul, and Latin.
And it came up with amazing, amazing art form to this day that resonates all over the world. What are some of the cool places that you've been, Crazy Legs, with this? I mean, you know, I've had a great opportunity to travel the world. I'm sure you have. Some of your coolest places. Not people always say to me, what's my favorite place? That's a hard question to answer.
Yeah.
Some of the coolest, yeah. Some of your favorite places.
I think St. Petersburg, Russia is pretty cool.
Yes.
You know, because of that club life. In order to be a part of that club life, there's an actual island. But at a certain time in St. Petersburg, this island closes. So the club stays popping all night.
Wow.
Until the boats start moving again. You can't leave the island unless you have a private boat.
Wow.
Wow.
So there's never a dull moment. Once it hits a certain time, boats stop, it stays packed.
Whoa.
I found that interesting. And you know...
Can't escape the party.
No, you can't. You know, you are the party. And you know, when you think of places that you And I'll tell you one thing, and I don't know if this happened to you, but when I first started traveling... And I've been through 6 passports already.
Oh, yeah. I got a few. Yeah, I know what you mean.
when I first started traveling, when we grew up wanting to dance, battle against each other, you know, do whatever we were doing in the streets. I'm not going to get into that. it's a family show.
Right.
traveling around, I didn't really appreciate my first go around.
Mm.
In the entertainment world, like we would go to places like France and be like, yo, take us to the hood, because we didn't want to hang out with what we thought were corny touristy.
You don't want to be on the Champs-Élysées,
nothing in common with us.
Yeah, you don't want to hang out on the Champs-Élysées
people. Yeah, we want to hang out with the people from Africa,
right?
That's it, because that's the only people that we felt comfortable around, you know. So you have a lot of Nigerians there,
yeah.
Persians, mm-hmm. Turkish people, mm-hmm. People from Morocco. Those are the things that we felt comfortable with. And the funny thing is that when about 8 years ago, I went to France, and there's this guy who's a historian, and he's Moroccan. No, he's Algerian. And he was telling me, hey, do you understand why us as Africans got into breaking? And I'm like, why? He goes, when we saw Flashdance, we thought all of you guys were Algerian and stuff like that.
Mm.
So that he was like, that's why we got into it. You know, they, because Puerto Ricans, you know, if you're in Algeria and you're Puerto Rican, you look Algerian. You're just another form of African.
You got it. Wow. Now that's deep, man. No, seriously, because, you know, again, part of the great gift and the honor is to take this culture that came from the New York metropolitan area. Literally, that was the hub. It was right there, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut. And now, you know, we're in France and Germany. We're in Russia. We're in Croatia. We're in all these different countries. And every one of these places has their own version of it, which is even crazier. You know,
yeah.
That's the thing. I mean, here's something that, you know, and you can definitely feel me on this. Here's something that you grew up with, just like I grew up doing parties, okay? So it was ours. It belonged to us. But then I can go to Mannheim, Germany, and meet a kid that says that he has the exact same experience that I had. But it's Germany now. It's not New York. It's not Jersey.
Right.
It's Germany, yeah. You know? So it's wild.
Let me just interject really quickly, because one of the defining moments that took, you know, what Legs was doing, right, in the neighborhood, in the streets, you know, what you were doing, DJing on the mic and everything like that, one of the defining moments was Wild Style.
Yeah.
And that defining moment not only featured, you know, a young teenage Crazy Legs, but to be able to broadcast, right, the elements of hip hop to the world.
Yeah.
And then he goes on tour with it.
Right.
I mean, if you can, because I know it's hard and we're actually really short on time, I want to ask you about some of the projects you're working on. But with Wild Style, can you just, for the people, try to explain what it felt like to take rap or hip-hop and breaking and b-boying, like, on the road for the first time ever?
It was one big party, man. We went to Japan for the Wild Style tour. And as I was telling you, I have a whole bunch of photos from that tour that have never been published. Look, honestly, I could sit here and make up the most romantic sounding story. But at the end of the day, a lot of us who went on those tours were living double lives. Some of us would come back from tour and still be stick-up kids. We went out there for the party of it. We went out there. I'm going to tell you how reckless we were. On the flight to Japan, it was the original, what's that movie? Oh, God, why am I thinking? The plane movie. Oh, why am I thinking?
Airplane. Soul Plane.
Soul Plane.
Yeah.
Yeah, not Airplane. That's different.
Soul Plane.
But so it was, we were wilding. People were dealing on the plane.
Wow.
Let me just put it like that. And it was when you could smoke cigarettes in the back of the plane.
Right.
It didn't smell like cigarettes back there.
Oh, boy.
To the point where people were like, my manager comes up to me and says, hey, by the way, whatever you guys have on you, you better do it all because the police are waiting for you on the manager.
What?
They lied to us.
Yeah. Has this story been told before?
Yeah. I mean, we had a 16-hour flight, so whatever.
Right. Good point.
Trust me. Yeah.
Good point. We have such limited time, Crazy Legs, but you're working on a very, very cool tech project right now.
Yes.
Please tell us about it.
Talk about it, yes.
I, you know, to make this easier, I wrote something down. I'm going to do the elevator pitch.
Okay.
Modi is an app built for professionals across multiple industries who get paid for the time they spend over video with their customers and clients. And basically, we're trying to provide the best user experience for doing it. We take the pain out of getting paid for your time. We do that by automating payments so that people don't have to chase down money. We provide other tools like direct messaging and scheduling, so they don't need to use a growing collection of apps and kind of like a one stop. It's kind of like if Zelle and FaceTime and Instagram had a baby. You know, and there are things you can do, like, let's say if I said, hey, and by the way, we have these new Crazy Legs cups right here. You want to buy one? I could charge you with any app. You don't have to bounce around anywhere. And, you know, that normally causes you to lose a customer because they may be like, oh, man, my baby, I got to change my baby right now. You know, if you're it's great for accountants, lawyers, teachers, tutors, doctors. It's a real professional app, and we're actually in the final phase of our seed funding. And the company is predominantly people of color, which I love the most.
Yes, that's beautiful.
And the woman that we're actually, more than likely, it's a woman that we're gonna be bringing on to, there's gonna be two people leading the company, CEO, CEO, and we're not sure which title the woman is gonna take, but we have one of the sickest, illest boss ass women in the game jumping on board. The kind of woman that Google will be like, oh shit, why is she going over there?
There you go.
Yeah. We have one of the most incredible tech law firms in the world representing us.
Cool.
And they don't rock with you if you don't have something that's going to put some big money in their pockets.
And can you repeat the name of it?
Yeah, again? Repeat the name of it. Crazy Legs.
Modi.
Modi,
spell that.
M-O-T-I.
M-O-T-I.
And then you can go to modiapp.com.
What is it?
Modiapp.com.
Modiapp.com. Crazy Legs.
Yeah.
I want to say thank you, man. It's been very, 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 very fun, man. This is awesome. I look forward to seeing you somewhere in the future, man. Okay.
But also, he's still like really, really, you know, he's also still really doing it. So, Crazy Legs, if people want to, like, you know, book you to be a judge or to appear on their show or to whatever like that, please give them an email address or your Instagram account. Where can they
find you?
Yeah.
Crazy Legs BX on Instagram, and then we'll take it from there.
Okay.
Nice.
Yes. All right, Crazy Legs.
Thank you so much for being with
Appreciate
us.
Appreciate it. Have a great one and Happy New Year.
Thank you. Same to you.
Thank you.
All the best.
All right. Peace.
All right.
Only because that was amazing. I felt like we could literally keep going for two more hours.
Continue.
Like, we didn't even scratch.
Right,
like,
he's amazing, man.
I mean, like, wow.
Okay, we're going to go into your health segment, yes. But I just really want to quickly point out one of the most interesting things. Is that, do you remember the movie Flashdance?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, guess who was the dance body double for Jennifer Beals wearing a wig?
No.
J-Lo.
Crazy Legs.
No!
No!
Jennifer Beals body double wearing a wig.
Stop
in Flashdance.
Really?
And like a zillion other things. I think this is going to be the first part.
We got a two-part
of a 17-part series.
Yeah, we got a two-part this.
Called The History of Crazy Legs.
Okay.
Amazing.
Go to your health segment. All in a segment
we
call.
So I strive to eat healthy. My goal in life is not to be rich or wealthy, cause true wealth comes from good health and wise ways. We got to start taking better care of ourselves. Be healthy, y'all.
Be healthy, y'all.
What's up, y'all?
Be nice.
Well, I'm not really nice to RBI. Turn it off! Okay.
You got 4 minutes to be
healthy. Yes.
All
okay.
All this hostility.
Okay. Yeah, I'm a little uptight.
Breathe.
It's been a while. Speaking of that, so listen, how you doing? You good?
All great. I'm great.
Yeah, I'm doing good and getting better. Working to be great. So I want to get into this segment. And I was actually gifted again this information. Again, I'm a huge component of strength training. I'm a huge component of, you know, physical fitness, calisthenics, et cetera. And I ran across this whole situation where people are now starting to instrument strength training, lifting,
mm-hmm.
to help combat PTSD.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You know, of being, you know, like if it's a person that came from a military situation, you know, a traumatic situation and all these different things that are going on in the world right now. What happens is that the way that you have to incorporate your muscles along with your thoughts, along with the energies and the endorphins that come out of you when you strength train, it helps kind of mellow you out. Mm. It's almost like a natural medicine. You know, it also gives you an opportunity to zone in, because with PTSD, you have a tendency also to have issues being around a lot of people. You know what
True.
I mean? Yeah, it becomes a very. I'm somewhat socially awkward, but I don't have PTSD. But I can only imagine what it's like for a person. Let's say they were in a group situation, and it caused for some kind of, you know, negative effect.
Right.
For them now to try to be able to move around is a very difficult thing. So strength training has a real positive impact on putting you. One of the things you got to do is you got to focus. When you're focusing on, imagine you're trying to do like hack squats or whatever. When you focus on that, you have to take all of the other thoughts and get them out of your mind. It's like a refresh. It's like a reboot of your brain.
Okay.
And not only that, the more you get into the workout, the more the better you feel. So the deeper you get into your workout, the better you feel, the clearer your mind is.
Mm.
So this is why I think this is a great, great thing. And I wanted to bring that up to people because there's so many people that tune in that are having these issues. Again, like I said, you might be in a domestic situation, and you know, there's post-traumatic stress behind that. You know, you come out of a domestic situation.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You might have been in a public setting. I don't really like to give a lot of airplay to those public things, but you know what I'm talking about,
right.
Where, you know, this, that, and the third happens. Okay. You might be a young person that's doing that. You might be an elderly person that you might have had something done to you directly, you know. Try to incorporate this. Just try to see what it's like. You feel what I'm coming from?
I feel you. And we're also, I believe, collectively and individually suffering from PTSD just from the whole COVID situation.
Oh, totally.
Right?
Oh, yeah, totally.
And everything we've experienced since then. So yeah.
Absolutely.
Before we went to holiday break, I'm getting back into strength training. And I can really appreciate this.
You can feel the difference, right?
Definitely.
Absolutely. I'm telling you.
Energy levels. Yes. Maintaining equanimity.
Yes.
Being able to handle stressful situations and navigate them differently. I definitely feel a difference. What?
People really, and this is the thing, stress is probably the greatest downfall, the greatest enemy to the human body. The stress. Stress can wipe you out.
Oh, it's a silent killer.
It can
is the
literally wipe you out. And this, I'm telling you, You get rid of the stress because you're working against it with your own abilities.
That's right.
You know, and it really makes a difference. I'm telling you guys, stress is a killer. And if you can figure out a way to deal with that, believe me, like you said. Yeah?
Absolutely. Okay, cool. 100%.
All right. All right.
You did good.
We're going to stay with that.
And it's abbreviated.
Yes, we did. Yes. We did it tight.
We kept it.
Yeah, we had to get it good. But so think about that, everybody. But moving right along, you know what we're getting ready to do. And I'm telling you right now, I'm going to be pissed off. I'm just going to say it ahead of time. We're going to come back with RBI.
No, we're not coming anywhere. We're going right into it.
I was
going
to try to get myself
because
together.
We are.
All right, go ahead. It's a full-time jack move.
Yeah, man. So I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do, just kind of reeling from the news.
Mm.
And I decided I'm going to do something in honor of my man, Black Indian.
Okay. All right. So I'll give you a pass then.
When he was getting, thank you, G. When he was getting into his zone as an MC, two of his favorite MCs were Buckshot from Black Moon and Prodigy from Mobb Deep. And at one point, it was almost assumed that he was Prodigy. He was so influenced by Prodigy. So in honor of him, I'm going to pick a song from Esther Phillips that Mobb Deep used for one of their classics. And a few other people have used it, you know. So let me get this joint queued up. It's called That's All Right With Me. And let's get this joint going.
If you wanna make love to me, if you want to make me,
did Big Noise use the beginning part two?
Yeah, we'll get into it.
It's not my second.
Nah, you're fine. I'm not sure if Big Noise, but somebody else did. Yeah. Somebody else did. Let's get into a few joints.
The act of making love is pink cookies in a plastic bag, getting crushed by buildings. Pink cookies in a plastic bag, getting crushed by buildings. I take money, electric chairs.
The shouts to LL. We just had a birthday recently too. Easy Mode B. LL combination. Shouts to Pastor G, who also had a birthday recently.
That's right, baby.
Let me get this other joint on real quick. So this is Mobb D. Take it to Mobb.
No one's ever said that. That's interesting.
Hey, yo, Queens, get the money, long time, no cash. We're caught up in the hustle and the
yeah, it's Mobb D with featuring Big Noise.
So I had to think fast, pull out my heat first.
I knew Noise was in there somewhere.
Yes, I think you may be.
Who produced this track?
Q-Tip.
Q-Tip?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The snare is amazing in this track.
Classic Q-Tip
snare.
Best snare
ever.
You might be right.
Can't stop till I'm eating off a platinum plate. Po-Po comes around and tries to relocate.
You might be right.
Lock me up forever, but they can't deflect me because.
So shout to Prodigy too. Rest in peace to Prodigy from Mobb Deep, another titan that we lost. And I'm thinking that you're thinking about this one right here, Boom.
Hey, yo.
What's up?
It's a lot of motherfuckers out here with a style similar to mine nowadays. You know what I mean? They're trying to, like, they
2022.
Camp, and now they want to take
Ducky.
The
hip-hop
for their own.
You see
the
Ducky?
No.
Yo.
Because it's just like, whatever, you know what I'm saying?
It's too strategical and mathematical. I rotate so fast that I appear in this. I keep it chemical.
Yes. I agree. This is a great sample source, you know? Well, look, G, I know you're angry right now, but I'm about to make you happy. Check this out, look. We're going to take it to your hometown.
You dirty dog. He said you dirty dog.
Shouts to Faith Evans. That's New Jersey's own Faith Evans, man. Get a smile on your face, man.
No!
What is ball at you?
Oh my god. It's so violent.
We're gonna take you to North Carolina next.
Uh-oh. Who knows what tomorrow brings?
Mm. Just wanna let faith serenade
and
us.
Only knows what's on the other side of the rainbow.
I love what hip hop and R&B does with samples. Shout out to the culture. Celebrating 50 this year.
Yeah. 5-0. Let's take a hit. The big 6-1.
I said North Carolina, but it's really VA. Rapper Big Pooh.
Knots.
And Knots Raw.
Oh, Knots is the man.
Yes, indeed. Shouts to Knots, too. Knots and Beat, they had a thing with Gene Brown in North Carolina. Had a nice beat battle representing VA.
How you doing? My name is Rapper. Poobie, if you nasty, you trying to get backstage, girl? Then just ask me. Nah, no need for passes. So I'm all access. You say you all in. I
but
trust
you know, this
you
one is
practice.
North Carolina. This is one of the new classic MCs, one of the newer legends from the last class of great MCs, Fayetteville's own J. Cole.
Woo. That was well said.
Shout out to J. Cole.
Yes.
Hip hop is alive, man.
Hip hop is alive.
50 years, man. Yo, G Mac is we ain't in New Jersey no more. Yeah, let's hear him rhyme.
Grown up and smoke my sins away. Ooh. I like
oh,
to go
yeah.
to Central Pay. Maybe I go, maybe I stay.
Maybe I stay.
She asked me if I'm scared to fly. To tell the truth, I'm terrified. I never been that high before.
Mm. Yeah, man, so that's Esther Phillips. That's our sweet on Esther. Once again, rest in peace to Black Indian. Rest in peace
rest
to
in peace.
Rest in peace.
Prodigy.
Rest in peace,
well, I'm
telling you. Celebrate hip hop, though. Once again, happy
if
birthday
you
to Master
make
G.
Love
oh, bless your heart. It's been great.
This might be one of our best shows.
This, is
was
really,
amazing.
This is amazing.
This is very special. We honored people.
Yes.
We spoke with kings.
Yes, we did.
Yes.
We honored some of the greatest samples and songs in hip hop history. You told them how to be healthy.
I did.
It's just mind blowing.
Whatever.
It's what unbelievable.
Is. Let's go. All right. So, look, you know the deal. This is Master G Theater. We're doing this thing on a basis that makes sure that you get this information coming to you from the hip. So, peace, love, and. Oh, no. That's another
Air
show.
Grease.
tell them where they can find you, DJ Boom.
At DJ Boom underscore LV.
Tell them where they can find you, CLB.
At IMCLB Online and at National Hip Hop Museum.
Yes. RBI.
At DJ underscore RBI.
And it's at Master G, Sugarhill. You guys keep it on. Keep it grooving. Thank you for listening. It's really a wild ride. Thanks again. Peace, y'all. And
peace.
We are out of here.